It's a great pleasure for me to introduce Dragan Marušić, from the University of Greenwich. And he will speak on even closeness of Venice.
Thank you, Sasha, for the introduction, and most of all, thank you. Thank you, Elena, and the organizers for inviting me. Okay, so I will speak on my usual subject, but extensively perhaps in regards to the full automorphism group and how one could sort of approach this problem through investigation of those automorphisms that act as even permutations as opposed to those that act as odd permutations. So I will go over the definition very briefly, but I would like to take an alternative point of view to understand and see vertex transitive graphs as combinatorial structures arising from pairs of groups when one group is separate from the other. Towards the end, I will give you a recent result on cubic symmetric graphs, where we have analyzed completely the situation with regards to the existence of all automorphisms. First of all, just I know that this is the topic of the conference, and one shouldn't really spend too much time on it. But anyway, when the automorphism group of the graph is large enough to ensure that you can get from every vertex to any other vertex by some automorphism, then we say that the graph is vertex transitive, the group acts transitively. And you have a vertex transitive graph on the right hand side of the slide. And
I'm thinking about a graph without much relation.
Oh, yes, sure. Sorry. A graph is just a simple graph for me, no loops, no multiple edges, just yeah. It's a symmetric relation, not containing identity relation. And the graph on the left hand side is not vertex transitive. If you take the complement of the graph on the left hand side, the complement is a union of a triangle and a quadrangle, and of course there is no way you can map a vertex which lies on a triangle to a vertex that lies on a quadrangle. So there are vertex transitive graphs and there are those which are not. Okay, so the usual definition graph is vertex transitive when for any pair of vertices there is an automorphism taking one vertex to the other. I want to replace this by a more natural approach to pairs of groups. So I have a group G and a subgroup H, and I take a coset space, be the left coset space, and there is a natural action of G on this coset space by a left multiplication in this case. And this action, of course, is transitive on the action of the group by left multiplication is transitive on the coset. But there is an additional action if you consider the action of G by left multiplication on the Cartesian product, on the Cartesian product of the coset space itself. Usually, the orbits of this action is never transitive, because the diagonal is always an orbit by itself. The number of orbits, the number of orbitals, as we call these orbits, is called the rank of the group, the action of the group. So what we do here, we can associate with this pair of groups graphs. Sometimes they can be directed graphs, but you can make them into undirected graphs with an appropriate operation. So what we do, we define a graph by taking as a vertex set the coset space, and as an edge set, take a union of orbitals. And if for some reason some orbital is not symmetric, That is, if UV is in there, but VU is not in there, just take the inverse orbital as well. The inverse orbital consists of precisely those VU for which UV is in the original orbital. If you do that, in other words, if you take the symmetric closure of the union of these orbitals, what you get is an appropriate set of edges. So you get an undirected graph. These graphs are usually called orbital graphs, and basic orbital graphs are precisely the ones which are associated with a single orbital. If the single orbital is self-paired, that is, if UV is in there, VU is also there, the graphs are also arc transitive, symmetric, that is, the group are also acts transitively on arcs. If the orbital is not symmetric, but you take closure, you take union of two inverse orbitals, then what you get is a graph that is edge transitive but not arc transitive, at least with respect to the edge. And such graphs have been called half arc transitive. But this is just in passing, it is not really essential for this talk. What is important is that with this construction, what we get is a vertex transitive graph, and vice versa, the opposite is also any vertex transitive graph is obtained precisely in this way. So if you look at the collection or the class of vertex transitive graphs, that is really just pairs of groups with appropriate combinatorial structure. And that's the way we like to look at this graph. Now, to give you two examples, first a cube. Of course, you can start with different kinds, with different groups H as your subgroups of a larger group. For example, what I mean is you can. I will give you two examples which both lead you to a cube. First, you take GS4 and HZ3 in S4. The number of the coset space has 8 cosets. The action of G on this coset is such that there is one orbital, which actually there are two orbitals of length 3. There's three orbitals altogether, apart from the diagonal. Okay, if you take away the diagonal, you're still left with three orbitals. One will give you just 4 edges. That would correspond to the antipodal points in the cube. So we have 4 antipodal points. And the other two will both give you the cube. And if you look at this picture, if one orbital graph is the graph consisting of, in this picture of, so each vertex is joined to its neighbor. Now if you define it from this graph another graph where you make pairs of adjacent points, those points which are at distance 2 on this graph, then you still get a cube. So in other words, the action of S4 on cosets of Z3 will give you 3 basic orbital graphs. The first one would be just a collection of 4 edges, and the other two would be isomorphic cubes. So S4 acting on Z3. But of course, the cube can also be obtained from a different pair. That is a much simpler construction. You just take H identity and take, for example, Z2 cubed. Then you identify the points of the cube with corresponding vector space. That just means that the automorphism of the cube contains Z2 cubed, but it also contains S4. And the natural question would then be, what is the full automorphism group? Maybe this one, just very briefly. A Cayley graph, this particular construction is a construction that gives rise to Cayley graphs. Cayley graphs are those vertex transitive graphs which can be constructed from pairs GH, where H is identity. That's the definition. There is. Full automorphism group of the graph of this of the cube is of course not S4, but it is S4 cross Z2. So in that sense, neither of the two constructions actually started with a full automorphism. The second example I want to give you is the Peterson graph. But before I do that, at this point I would like to make a definition, one that I mentioned before. If an automorphism of a vertex transitive graph acts as an even permutation, we will call it even permutation, and we will call it odd permutation if it acts as an odd automorphism. Now, in this case, I will mention it later, but I might as well mention it now. All permutations, all automorphisms of the cube are even permutations. The cube is a symmetric cubic graph. Those have been, those graphs have been investigated extensively. I have one on 10 vertices as well, the Peterson graph, and the obvious question is, if you look at the picture, you can see the rotation of order 5 as an obvious automorphism. You also can say that, well, there is an obvious reflection, yes, because the dihedral group is there, you know, you can see it from the picture. So rotation of order 5, a reflection along the vertical line, for example, will give you in total 10 automorphisms. These are automorphisms that fix the outer cycle and the inner star. There are also automorphisms that interchange the 5 star and the 5 cycle. You just have to do it in a right way, because if you look at the structure of the Peterson graph, you have this outer cycle and the inner star. In other words, you have the decomposition of the Peterson graph into two five cycles with a matching in between. But you can do this in 6 different ways. For example, if you take this 5 cycle, there is a complementary 5 cycle, this one, and you can, of course, you can rotate five times, and you get a total of 5 such compositions plus the original one. There are 6, precisely 6. Each of these 6 corresponds to one single 5 subgroup of the group. So, what is the full automorphism group? So, I have the rotation of order 5, reflection, which will give you the dihedral group, but there is also a mapping, an automorphism that maps this 5 cycle into this 5 star. I'll show you later how to do it. There are other automorphisms as well. So apart from the rotations and reflections, which are really obvious, and called semi-obvious, those which interchange inner and outer cycle, there are also automorphisms which do not recognize this decomposition into 2-5 cycles as the rigid one. The easiest way to see what the automorphism group is to represent the Peterson graph as a collection of 2 subsets of a 5 element set, and define the adjacency by saying the 2 subsets are adjacent if they have an empty intersection. In this way, you get this picture. And then it's from there on, it's easy, because every permutation in S5 induces an automorphism of this graph. For example, that will tell you that if you take, say, the transposition, just take a transposition which interchanges 1 and 2 and fixes the other 3 digits, then this one will be fixed. Yeah. because one and two are interchanged, but the two subsets are the same. These are fixed, the three neighbors are fixed because I'm fixing three, four, and five. And then what about this six? Well, this six guys here, they make a six cycle. So what happens is that I have to interchange these two because three is fixed, one and two interchange. I have to interchange those two and those two. There is a transposition induces an automorphism, four fixed points and three orbits of size two, which is another automorphism. In fact, odd elements of S5 in the natural action correspond to odd automorphisms in the action of degree 10, which gives it the Petersen graph, and same goes for even. That is not always the case. I mean, sometimes you can have a transitive group, say with containing odd permutations, but when you represent it in a different way as a group with different degree, different action, if you take a different subgroup, then you might lose this property of having odd automorphisms. Just another picture, same thing that we mentioned before. As said before, all automorphisms of the cube are even, whereas in the Petersen graph, I have all automorphisms as well. Now, here's I want to propose this problem. First of all, what is a two closure over for the group? I take a transitive group, H, and look at the. When I say a transitive group H, of course, I mean I already have H in a pair. So I have H with a subgroup J, and in the action of H, we call it J, gives me a transitive group. And now I construct all basic orbital graphs if for non-self pair orbitals you take the union, you close it up with a symmetrical one. So that you get an undirected graph. So you get a collection of all these graphs, and you look at the automorphism groups of these graphs. The intersection is called the two closure. So for each H, you can construct two closure. Of course, the two closure is H or something bigger. H is closed, is said to be two closed if it's two closure. And now I'm interested in, first of all, if I start with a group containing only even permutations, I will use even group for such a transitive group. I want to know, first of all, is it equal to its two closure? If not, what happens with the two closure? If H is even, is perhaps its two closure off? And even, and if that is not true, that means that what does it mean if you start with an even group and you take all the orbital graph, the basic orbital graph? The two closure would be all orbital graphs have an automorphism. If not, if there's at least one which does not have, then of course the two closure stays even. But in that case, is it possible to find at least one orbital graph which has this property that it contains all of the properties? If in that case, if there is at least one, then we say that H is orbital odd, and even close to this H, when no orbital graph, you cannot embed the group which you started with, the even group, into a larger transitive group containing odd permutations of automorphisms via orbital graph construction. Now, in the previous case, if we sort of test this definition or this problem with the example that I had before, the Petersen graph, for example, you can define the Petersen graph. There are three different transitive groups. One is full automorphism group, S5, one is A5, and one, there is a group for the 20. So for each of these three groups, you can do the construction and get the Petersen graph. In the case of the full automorphism, S5, the group, if that is G, what is H? H would be the hedral of, sorry, no, yeah, the hedral of order, the hedral of order. Yeah, the hedral of order 12. If you start with A5, then the H subgroup, the subgroup fixing a vertex, the point stabilizer would be S3. So A5 and closest of S3 will also give you a Petersen graph. And there is also a group of order 20. So that you take a Z2. So a group of order 20, a metacyclic group Z5, semi direct Z4, acting on closed sets of Z2 will also give you a Petersen graph. A5 only has even permutations, as I mentioned before. Because if you start, so A5, this is an even transitive permutation group. But there is one orbital graph, Petersen graph, which has all permutations. Incidentally, also the complement has, because the group has rank 3. So both orbital graphs have odd permutations. In fact, the closure is S5. S5 is a good closure of A5, and therefore we are done. So that would be to one end. But if you take, for example, there is a graph of order 102 cubic arising from the action of PSL 217 on S4, closest of S4. This graph does not have all permutations, all the automorphisms, but it neither has any other orbital graph of this particular group PSL 217 acting on S4. So all orbital graphs are without all automorphisms, and therefore this particular group, this action is such that it cannot be embedded into, cannot be extended into an R group, therefore it's invisible. And so are all the orbital graphs. Okay. How am I doing time wise? 20 minutes? Now, to give you why would one want to investigate this simple notion of being odd or even not being odd and so on. Well, even if you start with very simple classes of graphs, you will see that without heavy machinery, you cannot even answer this question. For example, there are integers, and twice the prime number is perhaps the simplest of all, where, in fact, all transitive groups of that degree can be extended, even if you start from even groups, they can be extended into odd groups. In other words, there are degrees for which all the two closures of all graphs associated with groups acting with that degree have all automorphisms. And twice the prime number is an example of that situation. And I'd like to go very briefly over this 5-minute analysis, because this cannot be proved without the classification of simple groups. Just to give you a feel for the problem. Now, what I would like to show here is that all transitive groups of degree twice a prime number can be extended by orbital graphs into groups containing odd elements. Or, in other words, I want to show that every vertex transitive graph for twice a prime number has all automorphisms. Now, the way you do it is you do this typical analysis. A vertex transitive graph of order twice a prime number is of three kinds, essentially. The group can be the primitive, so that means there is no invariant partition into smaller blocks being recognized by the group. So the action of the group is sort of hectic. And there are two other possibilities. There can be two blocks of size P, so all automorphisms either fix the two blocks or interchange the two blocks. And the third possibility is that there are P blocks of size 2. So you can decompose the vertex set into subsets of size 2, P of them, and every automorphism of the graph sort of takes blocks to blocks. And these are the three cases. First case, in my slide. If I have two blocks of size P, now the analysis goes like this.
Maybe also two.
Yeah, well, yes, but yes. No problem with P being two. But let's see. So whatever. Yes, even if that is the case. If the number is four, then yes, it is true that all groups contain let's not have people
stupid.
Oh, no, sorry. No. Yes, of course, that's okay. For p equals 2, you have four vertices, so there are two graphs on four cycle, and its complement, and the complete graph. The complete graph, of course, has all automorphisms, and the four cycle also has automorphisms. Just fix the two opposite vertices, so you can change the aperture. Yeah. So let's suppose from now on that p is odd, because we don't need p equals 2. So I have two blocks of size p, and then I have an element interchanging. Now this swap, call it swap, the simplest case would be where the swap is just p, it has p orbits of size p, just interchanges in blocks, in orbitals, all orbitals of size 2. In other words, there is a swap of 4 to 2. The swap of 4 to 2 would have p orbits of size 2, and of course would be an odd automorphism. But even if that is not the case, this is true whenever p is congruent to 3 modulo 4. P is a prime here, of course. But so if p is congruent to 3 modulo 4, this is the only possibility. A swap of order a prime power of 2 always has to be this kind, because you can show actually that every graph of 4 twice a prime number p congruent to 3 modulo 4 is a Cayley graph. Has to be a Cayley graph. And to be a Cayley graph, it is either a Cayley graph of a cyclic group or dihedral. In both cases, you have the elements of 4 to 2 which have p orbits of size. The second possibility when this happens, when p is congruent to 1 modulo 4, is that you can show that in this case, this swap, you can always choose it in such a way that it has order 4. I'm not a detail. You can represent, you can characterize the adjacencies in the graph in such a way that you actually can see that. Typical example is features in graph. You can show that the adjacencies in one block sort of define the adjacencies in the other block via a multiplier from the if I identify the vertices with ZP, so I have two copies of ZP, then I can take a multiplier in ZP star in non-zero elements, and this multiplier so it takes all elements from one block into the other. Maybe I'll show you. That's what happens with the Petersen graph.
You can get this swap
the outer morphism that takes the outer into inner and vice versa, just by doing this, you interchange 0 with 0 prime, and you map the other vertices in such a way that you multiply by 2. Your all indices are multiplied by 2 for the prime and the other two orbits are just you replace prime with non-prime. This is an outer morphism that interchanges the 2 5 cycles. And you can do this whenever 5 is 100, 5 is 1 modulo 4, and you can do this for every prime, and you can swap can be chosen in such a way that it is of order 4. T minus 1 is divisible by 4, you can do this, and then you count the number of orbits to see that there really is an odd number of such orbits. Now, the blocks of size 2, this comes from an older result of mine. All such graphs can be, sort of, with a trick, can be represented as those having two blocks of size p. If this is true, if G has blocks of size 2, then it must contain a subgroup H, smaller subgroup, which has blocks of size p, and then this group H itself will contain all automorphisms, and therefore G will also contain all automorphisms. Primitive cannot be done independently of. There is no classification of simple group, free proof of this fact, even though it seems to be a simple one. But the classification tells you that P equals 5 is the only example of a transitive primitive group of degree twice a primitive number. It only exists if p equals 5, it gives you the Petersen graph. Okay, so that's that is this short or brief analysis of case twice prime numbers. And as I mentioned before, at least to me, this is an odd situation where such a simple question cannot be asked without a classification. I'll try different tricks, but it didn't work. Perhaps some can. Okay, now I move on. Two examples of Cayley graphs of order 16. One is a Cayley graph of a cyclic group, one is a Cayley graph of a Hilbert group. They look very much the same, it's just one transformation of two edges on the left hand side, and you just cross them over and you get the Cayley graph of the other group. One has even and the other one does not. I'm slowly moving to cubic graphs. One thing that we can sort of see very easily, if the group acts regularly, so no fixed points, then the answer to the existence of all automorphisms is sort of run through Sylow group subgroups. It's just if the group is cyclic, then you do have all automorphisms. For example, whenever you have a Cayley graph for twice two modulo 4, then you obviously have automorphisms. This is just sort of in passing. I'm going to skip that. Now, I'm going to close with a couple more slides. We sort of try, in order to, in approaching this problem of starting with an even transitive group, what can you say about its two closure? In other words, are all basic orbital graphs, all vertex transitive graphs associated with this group? Do they all have all automorphisms or not? If yes, then the number is odd and you're happy. If not, is there at least one? Well, you have to start somewhere, and we started with the smallest possible valency, because that will give us at least a possibility to answer the question in general for all those group, transitive groups which have a suborbit of length p. That is precisely the same as having an orbital graph which is a cubic symmetric graph. So I'm going to tell you what we did here. Now, the cubic symmetric graph is probably far as algebraic graph theory goes, problems or research associated with group action, these class of graphs has really been extensively studied, and there's always something else popping up, and I can't believe that this notion of even odd is one such new thing. But the first result goes back to Tuck in 1947. There are 17 families of these graphs. If you do a very precise analysis of what can happen with respect to how transitive it is, you know, how big the group is, what are the vertex stabilizers and similar sort of properties with respect to this, I will give you in a minute. But first of all, if you look at the vertex stabilizers, at the size of the vertex stabilizer tells you what the degree of regularity is, as we call it. We say that the graph is S regular if I'm able to map any, if I'm able to find an automorphism taking an arc of a directed path of length S into another directed path of length S. And in other words, if the group is transitive on S, directed S paths, S arcs. And in that respect, there are five boxes, one regular, two regular, up to five. For example, the Peterson graph is three regular, because I'm in the Peterson graph, I can take any three arc, any three path directed, any other, and find an automorphism taking one into the other. With respect to that, the vertex stabilizers are given in the second column. The S stabilizers are given in the third column, and you can see that in the S stabilizer you have for S equals 2 and S equals 4, you have two possibilities. Either the S stabilizer is, for example, for S equals 2, it's Z4 or Z2. But that gives you a total of seven already. Now two boxes have already been sort of extended to two additional boxes. So I already have seven different types. But in fact, the types are 17, because it is convenient to do not only check or not only look at the full automorphism group. The full automorphism group can be either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 regular. And with respect to 2 regularity and 3 and 4 regularity, I have two possibilities in each case, depending on whether, you remember there in the previous slide, the S stabilizer, for example, for 2 regular graphs can be either Z2 plus Z2 or Z4. We can sort of combinatorially explain this or define this as saying, if I have a Z4, then I do not have an involution interchanging two adjacent vertices. If I have Z2 cross Z2, then I do have an involution interchanging two adjacent vertices. And with respect to that, 2 superscript 1 means I have an involution interchanging two adjacent vertices. 2 superscript 2, I do not have an involution. I need an element of order 4 in order to be able to interchange two adjacent vertices. And same happens for 4 regular, and I have 4 1 for 2. So these are the 7 types already. But now if I look at the maximum regularity in all possible sub-regularities, if you want subgroups being still regular, I have these 17 types. For example, the last row, second column, I have type 2, superscript 1, 2, superscript 2, and 3. That means that the full of the morphism group is irregular, but this it contains two subgroups. One is 2 regular with an evolution interchanging to adjacent vertices, and the other one is 2 regular, but it does not have such an evolution. Whereas, for example, the Peterson graph falls into category, I believe, 2-1, 3. It's 3 regular, it has a 2 regular, group. It does interchange. It changes to adjacent vertices. So Peterson graph is first row where it says, is it bipartite? Never. So graphs of that kind of never. Okay, so these are the 17 types. So what we did, we analyzed all of this. Sometimes it's very technical. Sometimes we had to use combinatorial results, combinatorial results from other sort of combinatorial fields, and sometimes we had to use group theoretic results. And what we got is, I will give you the full table. But for example, if you start with smaller one, yeah, K4 contains automorphisms, K3, yes, cube, no, Peterson graph, yes. Haywood graph, the graph, the Levi graph, or the Levy graph, or the Fano plane contains all automorphisms, and so on, and so on, and so on still. So these are, this comes from a paper by Marston Conder. It's an analysis of generators of all these 7 types of groups. But here is what the result is. Essentially, you know, one would expect that if the question even exists, even odd, is somehow an arithmetic question, so the answer should be arithmetic. In partially, it is true. In some cases, for example, you see, when do I have an odd optimum? The graph is always of order 2 times something. That something is either even or not, or odd. And it would be nice to have, okay, there is an odd automorphism, if and only if this something is odd. That would be the easiest possible answer. You see that in some cases that is precisely the case. But there are exceptions. In other words, there are graphs of particular types, and of order 2 times odd, when you need additional properties in order to have odd automorphisms. For example, you see line 1, 2, 3, so types 2, 1, and types 3, and types 4, 1, and types 5. There is an odd, but you need bipartite. So those which are not bipartite, they do not have odd. So that is an exception on the side for the, an extra condition, but sometimes you also get, there is one very interesting case line 92, row 2. Even though it is not to be expected to have all automorphisms when n is even, but there is a class of these graphs where defined in a very special way, you do get this additional property of having all automorphisms, even though n is not odd. You see n equals 2 to the k minus 1 times something. I wanted to show you this picture. So we come from a small coastal town of Slovenia, just across Trieste in Italy. We are.
That is Tirana.
Yes.
Not Porto Rosso.
See, I'm. They cheated a little, but when they allowed it for this organization, the math department, they cheated a little. Porto Rosso is so close. The venue is right in between. So anyway, we are the organizers of the next European Congress, which is a great opportunity, but a great honor for such a small place in the category of this. Huge cities where previous congresses were, and I believe that this would make a lot of activities in the math department in the next 4 years, and we certainly intend to organize conferences and workshops, in particular satellite conferences related to topics similar to this one today, and of course you'll be very welcome to come and
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think since we all used to say alternating group, which is actually not alternating, but otherwise, yeah, then we can excuse this small confusion between Pirani and Pantaros, yeah? Yeah, so these two have been like alternating. Thank you for coming here. Any questions? I just was wondering, for instance, if you take graph on this even closeness, If you, for instance, switch to, say, line graph, the whole story will be different. For instance, for Peterson graph, this is line graph, and this is group.
It really depends, because a graph is a pair of groups. I mean, it just depends on what pair of groups. You can take the same group, but different subgroup, and you have different results.
Also, start thinking in general, if you have like a subgroup of index 2, so can you always realize it so that this subgroup of index 2 show in outside of alternate group? I don't know. So in general, you're just talking that it's about the subgroup of index 2, and then
you can. You have examples of cubic symmetric graphs where you they have all automorphisms, but they have two kinds of subgroups of index 2, even and odd. Both can happen. Depending on, some funny things happen when you have three regular with 2-1 and 2-2 and five regular with 4-1 and 4-2. Sometimes it is difficult to understand.
Yeah, and in this cubic graph, I understand that you say, well, you can have involution interchange in A or not. Well, exactly, basically you just distinguish between two amalgams or whatever it is. Yeah. Just the way to see two different cases. Yeah.
Yes, but if you, so then this is the difference. You take a graph theoretic point of view, group theoretic, for graph theoretic people, it is easier to have some sort of material structure.
But the content is the same. Oh, so you know, other questions then? Then we'll have a break for 10 minutes.